Thank you. So we will begin. So I wanted to thank Arupadayyappa Institute of Technology, Vinayaka Missions Research Foundation for their opportunity here. And we will start. Okay, let's start. So let me go to the first slide. So this is the central dogma. You know, all most people who learn biotechnology, by the time they reach the end of the first year and they enter into the second year, they will immediately know what is central dogma. So this central dogma is fundamental in any subject, DNA to RNA, RNA to protein. So this has been drilled into your mind right from the beginning. But what is the next level information for this particular information? So can anybody please tell me what is the process from DNA to RNA and from RNA to protein? So always that confusion will be there. Where is
Transcription,
the
translation.
very good, very good. Transcription and translation. Very good. So we are having very good students today. Very
RNA is transcription.
Yes. Yes, very good. And? Good, thank you. So this was the central dogma. So this is fundamental. This information we know. Now let us go to the next stage. So this is the next level. See, the amount of information that we have at present is incredibly large. And it is when we talk about DNA, we no longer talk about only the DNA. We talk about, we will start from the nucleic acid, we go all the way up to DNA, and then we break the DNA back to its fundamental form, and then we reassemble it. So that is the kind of knowledge that we have. And when we reassemble it into various forms, we not only do it for one single strand, we are actually doing it for the entire organism. And when we do it for the entire organism, that entire body of knowledge you're gaining, that is called as genomics. So this became very popular during the 90s. Okay. And now you go on to transcriptomics. So when you are transcribing it, what happens? What is the fate of the DNA? What happens when it becomes an RNA? How does it translate into a protein? All of these things get into transcriptomics, huge body of knowledge. Then you progress further into proteomics. It is a huge field. You see, back in 2003, when I was doing my PG diploma in bioinformatics, so during the speaker profile, they told, you know, all these courses I learned. So during the, so God has given the opportunity to get educated, so we are all getting educated. So when we are learning this bioinformatics, at my time, this information stopped with the BLAST, FASTA, and the protein structure, okay, the primary, secondary, and tertiary structure. That was all. It was a very big thing to, you know, even predict the structure up to the secondary stage. But now it is moved much more beyond that. Now everybody is talking about molecular docking. Throughout your WhatsApp or social media, you can see several training programs on molecular docking, drug discovery, drug designing, primer designing. So this is something called the whole area of proteomics has developed and mushroomed into a huge area. Next level, when you go, once you learn about the DNA, once you learn about the transcriptomics, and then you go into the proteomics, then you are actually trying to unravel the working of the cell, the different metabolic processes, which means in the beginning of BTech biotechnology, you will be learning a subject called biochemistry. Then you will learn a subject called principles of chemical engineering. And then you will forget all about both of the subjects. So this is perfectly natural. But the real implications of both these subjects is that what is the underlying metabolic functions of the cell? How does the cell work? How does one cell talk to another cell? What is this COVID, this virus is doing, coronavirus is doing? How is it able to bring all the lung cells together, clump them together, create all this nuisance? How is it able to do that? What is happening to our metabolism? So metabolomics, that is a huge area now, which is mushrooming like anything. And finally, all this information gives you the description of the biological phenotype. So the central dogma is no longer DNA to RNA to protein. It is much beyond that. So please learn about each and every single aspect of these things, sir. Next, we will see. So I have been telling omics, 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 omics. So this omics is a very, very new subject. If you look at the Department of Biotechnology's teaching courses also from the Government of India, you will see that a lot of elective subjects are based on omics. And there are lots of papers which nowadays students are learning about transcriptomics, genomics, proteomics. It is no longer about protein structure. So omics is a very, very important area in biotechnology. And this is the next generation biotechnology. Fine. So let us go to something interesting. How many of you know this guy? very famous leader.
Kim Jong Un.
Ah, Kim Jong One or Kim Jong Two? I am also not sure. Is the current ruler of North Korea, right? So you know him very well. That you know that the entire country is shrouded in mystery. And can you see behind him? Arrow mark is pointing to a structure. What is that structure? It is the structure of his toilet. Okay. I was using the colloquial term. That is the structure of the restroom. So this leader has the habit of carrying his restroom wherever he goes. So whether he come to India also as a guest, chief guest, if he is coming, he will bring the restroom along with him, and he will take the restroom and the contents which he deposits in the restroom along with him. Why does he do that? So what is the secret behind that? The secret behind that is he does not want anybody to know his biological data. So biological data or omics data is going to be very, very precious. Like what you are storing in your external hard drive or what you are storing in your computer, that data, similarly, the biological data can now be read. So let us see what kind of information he's afraid of. Very, very simple things. You see, just from the color of the urine, you can understand so many complications. You can understand whether you are taking any drugs, you are taking what is your health relation, what is your health status, whether you are suffering from dehydration, what is the water retention capacity of the cell, to which drugs are you susceptible, whether you are diabetic or not. All these things, this is called as the color spectrum of the urine. So just from the biochemistry of the urine, you might learn biochemistry, you will be doing a lot of biochemical tests. But what is the application of that? The application comes in such areas. So colors of the urine. Now I will go to something very, very pleasant. Okay, the opposite of pleasant. So stool. So from the urine, you can understand all those things. From the stool, from the shape of the stool, this is the Bristol stool chart. This is a standard chart used in biology. Nowadays, the funny thing is that most students who are learning biotechnology, they do not concentrate on all these things. Back in the days when we were learning microbiology or biotechnology, we used to concentrate on these aspects because these are the areas where the diagnosis helps you understand very serious conditions like carcinoma, colitis, shigellosis, salmonellosis, CBD obstructions, cystic fibrosis, mucus colitis, so many diseases we could understand at that time just by looking at the stool. And you have a lot of WBCs. When you look at the blood, when you look at the microscopic area, you have a lot of WBCs. And those things also reveal the health status of the individual. So I hope you are now able to understand why this man is so clever. So he is able to carry his restroom. It may appear very funny and very comical to many people, but from the biotechnological aspect of point of view, this is a very important aspect of biosecurity. So I can call it as one of the security measures. This is called biosecurity, we can call it. So we are going for the I thought of making a meme about this. So it is for the students. You can see, you might recall this very incredible scene from one old Tamil movie. Now, sir, what are you saying? So with the urine and feces sample, I can download your entire omics. So this is information, and information is wealth. Now you see, you are able to see a lot of data wars going on between all the major companies, and a lot of privacy battles are being fought. But most of these privacy battles are being fought for corporate information or information about the client or amount of sales or revenue. But you see, the next generation data, which is going to be extremely valuable and important, is personal health data. So your health data, your omics, your genomic data, your proteomic data, your transcriptomic data, all of this omics data, whichever I showed you, that data is going to be the major data point from which billions of dollars are going to be made. So you must be ready for understanding that information science or information technology is going to be the extension of biotechnology in the coming future. So now we will go to the next aspect of this talk. So we saw that there are omics here. Omics is there. Omics, lot of information is there. Now there is a talk which is recently going on in the area of biotechnology. And it has already been explained in our ancient system. As is the mind, so is the speech. As is the speech, so is the action. Of the good people, there is uniformity in mind, speech, and action. So whatever you are thinking only, you will speak. Whatever you speak only, you will do. So there is a Sanskrit saying like this. But the problem is that traditionally we have been taught that our behavior or our appearance and everything, all of these things, they are dependent on what? Either the genotype or the phenotype. And you have hereditary traits. So these are the traditional ways in which we have been taught till now. But unfortunately, recently there is a lot of evidence which suggests that live editing is going on. So ever since CRISPR technology has been revealed to the world, there is a lot of talk about going on about live editing of the genes which are happening as the person is alive. And this has actually been happening by nature for a very long time. And this area now, interestingly, is, I will tell the word in a few minutes. So I want to know some answers from my dear students who are attending this talk now. Let us see if you paid any attention to molecular biology class. So what do you think is, because if I speak with my headphone, both the plugs inside my ear, I am able to hear only myself talking inside the room. So now I think it's very clear. I hope my audio is clear. Let me do a brief checkup. Now, let's see if you paid any attention to this molecular biology class. So how many of you heard about these two terms, methylation, acetylation and deacetylation? So these two words will come in between the subject. So in the around the middle of the molecular biology talk by your teacher, they will be mentioning these two aspects. So I do not know how many of you paid attention in the class. Can anybody please tell me what is methylation and what is acetylization?
Sir, adding of methyl group to a compound is methylation, and adding of acetyl group to a compound is acetylation. And similarly, removing of acetyl group is deacetylation.
Very good, very good, very good. So adding of a methyl group is methylation. So what do you think happens when a methyl group is added? Why should it get added? Any idea? So this talk is a general talk to get your interest. So think of it as a switch on, switch off, switch. So when we go to the central dogma, DNA to RNA, RNA to protein, and then we went on to omics, and then we went on to Kim Jong, we went to the omics data, what can be generated from a urine and feces sample, and then now we are here, methylation and deacetylization or acetylization. So the expression of the genes is regulated very often by the presence of these two chemicals. So the methyl group or the acetyl group, it is often getting involved in these activities, and this has been proven. Now let us see the next thing. So this is methylation, the addition of a CH3 group, and that is the process of acetylation. So you can see that in the formation of cancer cells or in the formation of any biological activity, these kinds of functions are often associated with it. So you will have to pay very close attention to this, because these have several serious implications. What are the serious implications? This leads to an area called epigenetics. So what is this yellow structure that you are seeing all of this picture? This picture is, anybody can take it from the internet now. But what is this? What am I trying to show here? Anybody? So don't worry, even if you're not answering by now, I have become used to the online class where students don't answer, but we teachers, we still keep talking. So don't worry about all these things. I will not get offended, because we have developed extremely thick digital skin in this process. So anybody would like to tell what is going on here very quickly so that we move on? Have you seen this picture before?
Regulation, sir. Histones.
Very good, very good. Okay, very good. So histone proteins, you are able to see histones, you are able to see the chromatin fiber, you are able to see the entire chromatin network, how they organize into a chromosome. So the entire unraveling and repackaging of the DNA into the chromosome, that you are able to see. So here, the process of methylation and acetylation will go on. So now you go back to your books and you read where it is happening, why is it is happening, it's because there is not enough time in this lecture to explain that, but what I want to tell you is these things are happening regularly, and the rate at which the methylation or the acetylation is taking place depending on the environmental factors. So somebody is scolding you today continuously for 5 days, your teacher is shouting at you, then you become upset. Then what happens? There are certain metabolic changes which are happening. These metabolic changes which are happening instantaneously, they get registered at the genetic level. And what gets registered at the genetic level, it will also get passed on to the next generation. And it, in the future, I will not be surprised if in 5 or 10 years they will tell that epigenetics actually creates changes within the organism in the current generation itself. That is, in you itself, it creates a lot of changes. So we say maturity, emotional maturity, the person has become emotionally mature. It may have a genetic underlying factor in it. So behavioral changes. So why I am telling all these things? Is there any implication to this? The real implication to this is in the development of psychotropic drugs. When you are developing drugs for neurological problems, you can actually try to change the neurochemistry by doing these genetic manipulations, by giving medicines which can alter the amount of methylation or acetylation. So that is the level of precision medicine that can be given. And this epigenetics is the latest area in biotechnology where a lot of developments are taking place. So you can see a very simple diagram here. Your DNA contains the recipe for making proteins, but here, this is where you interact with the environment. These are all the factors where you interact with the environment: food, exercise, air, etc., drugs, stress, sleep. So all of these areas are where you are actually interacting with the environment. So the environmental inputs will create the unique requirement for your cell. See, if you are put in Antarctica, then you will want to have certain necessities for your cell. Then your cells will develop certain enzymes, it will secrete certain enzymes, it will do certain things, and these things actually get registered. So now the trend is that nature versus nurture is becoming nature and nurture. Okay, so I think we have spoken quite a lot here now. So what have we seen so far? Let us recall whatever we have seen: genomics, proteomics, metabolomics, metagenomics, transcriptomics. Then, so metagenomics is for huge amount of information, genetic information in the environmental sample. Then we saw about epigenetics. So to summarize, the biological cell has a lot of data, huge amount of data, this more than huge amount of data, metadata. So all this metadata is information. And as I told you in the cartoon, information is wealth. So what skills does a biotechnology student need in order to understand all these things? So please understand that apart from learning the traditional subjects, you must learn these subjects also in order to cope up with the future, because the future is going to be omics future. So data analytics you have to learn, big data you have to understand what is big data. Okay, then Python programming, basic coding you should know, especially Python programming, because that is the syntax which is most happening now. Then you must understand data mining. Can anybody try to tell what is data mining? So very, very simple to understand. Earlier and all, we used to search for data. Now searching in Google is like data mining. So simple data mining skills you will need, very advanced data mining skills you will need. You will need to learn specific tools which are used for data mining. And any other subjects are there? Okay, we will see what are the other subjects that are there. Fine. Now you see, there is a lot of skill that you need apart from biotechnology. Now, where I told you DNA to RNA, RNA to protein, protein to so on. Now, expression of a gene, methylation, alkylation, expression of a gene. So gene expression analysis that is done. Okay, we are saying gene is getting switched on, it is getting switched off, we are saying. But how do we do it in the laboratory? How do we analyze the expression profile of a particular experimental system? So one of the most important or easiest methods that is used to see microarray analysis. And microarray analysis has evolved to a lot of incredible fields. And here you can find out that in microarray analysis, you have not only the genetic data, you need to interpret that genetic data with image analysis software. So biotechnology people alone are not doing biotechnology work. ECE people are doing biotechnology work. EEE people are doing biotechnology work. E&I people are doing biotechnology work. So image processing is a technology which is going to be very closely related to biotechnology now. So you can look at the paper. Most of you can take down that paper also. Later I can send you this paper also if you want. I will send it to HOD madam. So microarray image analysis, from image processing method to gene expression level estimation. So image processing technology is not related to the electronic domain. It is extremely crucial to understanding gene expression profiles for the entire genome, no, forget the genome, for the entire proteome, no, forget the proteome, for the entire metabolome, forget the metabolome, for the entire transcriptome, forget the transcriptome. So metagenomics, metadata, that data expression profile and the implications of this. This will be merged with the implications. What does this expression profile mean? How, what is the data which is getting switched on and switched off? Earlier, you used to take a calculator and used to calculate. Now it is not necessary. These things are done using supercomputers. So you must become familiar with these things. Now, moving on to the next stage, agriculture or precision agriculture. Okay, so this is the next feature. So first we have seen omics, then we have seen this. Now we are seeing the agriculture. So earlier when biotechnology people used to learn about biotechnology, the only most important thing about agriculture, what we used to learn, at least when I was a student, is biofertilizer, biopesticide. Two things only I will know. Okay, then I will know Aspergillus, Niger, Rhizopus. Then I will remember a few names of the microorganisms. Then I will write it down in the paper and the teacher will give me the mark. But today the situation is not like that. You are not escaping with just a degree. You need skill set. So the agricultural area has seen a lot of development in microbiology, in biotechnology, and it is no longer just about using biopesticide or organic agriculture. All those things have gone now. Now, precisely how much carbon you are giving, how much nitrogen you are giving, that will result in this much growth. Very, very carefully they are calculating, because the crop yield directly translates into market potential. So now what happens is this precision agriculture. For this, there are methodologies which do not require soil. So soilless agriculture. Without soil, you are doing the agriculture, because you have understood that soil is, although it is as good as a substrate, it also contains a lot of contamination, and it is very difficult to remove the contamination and take care of the plant. So now very concentrated forms of growing the crops have come, and the next generation of agriculture has come. So let us see what they are. So I hope you are familiar with this. This is a facility in Dabur in New Delhi. This area is called hydroponics. So what they are using is NFT technique. Okay, so it's a film technique where only liquid nutrients are flowing. There is absolutely no soil. You can see a raised platform, and the scale of the plant, the entire climate is controlled. It is a microclimate controlled environment. The entire climate is controlled using precision computational facilities. And I'm coming to that technology now. I'll tell you what kind of technologies are involved in that. So number one, no soil. Number two, indoors. Number three, more yield than what you will see in the outdoor crops. So these are the kinds of technologies that you can see. Is this slide visible? Just I will take an interim check before I move on.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir. So in the left side, that big picture, you can see these pictures are courtesy of Future Farms. This is a Chennai-based hydroponics company. It is one of the largest companies in India. So in the left, you can see that the crop, how it is growing without soil. And you can see the roots. All these roots, they soak up the nutrients. So that is the basic principle. How does a plant grow? A plant grows with nutrients. If you are able to give that nutrients, it is not bothering whether it is taking the nutrient from the soil or not. You will give a cup which will hold the plant, so it is a substrate. And you are giving nutrients which are passing through. Very easy. It will simply drink the nutrients and it grow. So that is what this is all about. But it is not so simple. If you want to control the nutrients, if you want to control the environment in which the plant is growing, then you will need some sophisticated systems, and you will have to merge it with what is called as Internet of Things. So here you can see that all the positions, all the status, health status of the plant, the health status of the environment, everything can be monitored using a simple cell phone app. And a lot of electronics is there, a lot of sensor technology is there. And these technologies are dependent on biological data, previously available biological data, data, data. What is data? Big data. So the first skill set that I told, data analytics. So all those things information is to thing. So we are bordering out in data analytics, going into Internet of Things, and moving on to artificial intelligence, where this particular greenhouse is actually capable of taking decisions. When to switch on the fan, when to reduce the temperature, when to increase the temperature, when to pour more nutrients, when to add more nitrogen. All these decisions are automatically taken. And please understand that only one or two people will be there in this, such a big facility. So it is a really amazing piece of technology that is going to come. And biotechnology is at the crux of this. Right. So next level of biotechnology, where we have to take it to outer space. So NASA is doing a lot of work in this. You can see that they have already succeeded in growing the plants in the International Space Station. And this is a very interesting paper by NASA. It's a fact sheet paper. You can read all about it. They have actually contributed to the artificial environment. Now, you see, to put it in perspective, I will tell you, when I was doing my PhD between 2005 and 2010, that time around 2006, okay, you imagine how long ago it is. Okay, around 2006 itself in Germany, you know, they had what is called as the artificial ecosystem. There is a university in Leipzig, Germany, where one professor was working in artificial ecosystem and he was using ion chromatography to predict the fate of nutrients. And today you can see that those technologies have evolved and now they are able to create an artificial system, not in Earth, but in outer space. So there are a lot of challenges in growing plant in outer space. There is the gravitation, there is the movement of the space station itself at a very large, it's just rotating. And plant is growing, how it is growing, and there is no soil. So what is happening there? How are they doing it? So it is impossible without understanding big data. Again, big data. What big data? Plant informatics. So plant informatics is a very big information that we need. We need proper information of what nutrients are going on. We need very good quality sensors. So biotechnology is no longer about, you know, understanding the movement of the water from here to there or osmosis. No, it is about understanding the movement of ions. Where exactly these ions are going, how these ions are getting exchanged. So all of these things are very, very important. So now we will stop at that point for now and say what skills you need to learn. Okay. Plant informatics. Okay. That is one area you need to learn. Precision agriculture. That is another area you need to learn. Biogeochemistry. So this area actually merges all the aspects of biology, geology, and chemistry. Then only you can do precision agriculture. Internet of things. Why? Anybody? Okay. Internet of things, IoT, is because we need to link up all of these things together. And you need to know biophysics. Why do you need to know biophysics? Because you need to understand that if you are trying to grow plants in space or you are trying to grow plants in any altered environment, you should understand that the rules of totipotency, which you learn in plant tissue culture, and the rules of geotrophism, all of these things don't apply in outer space. Then they do something else. They will be totipotent, but they will grow in this and that direction in outer space. So how do you regulate that? Then in order to regulate the callus formation in a particular level, it is not so simple as doing it in Earth. In Earth, you can just add these four hormones, cytokinin, gibberellin, abscisic acid, and ethylene dioxide. Very, very easy. But in outer space, just adding these hormones will not do. You will have to regulate the callus formation in a certain extent, which means genetic manipulation is required, which means the germplasm that you are taking to outer space has to be genetically modified in such a way that the development of the callus will be oriented towards a particular area. So this is real deep genetic engineering, which you must try to comprehend. And this is not possible without data. What is the data? Omics data. And what is that omics data? Coming from the central dogma. So whatever you learn from the beginning, you have to transfer it all the way to the end. And then you should understand that during when we were learning, the subject was called botany. Then it became plant biotechnology. Today it is called precision agriculture. Tomorrow what it will be called? God only knows. But you should learn to adapt with the times. So these are the new subjects that you will have to learn in addition to your traditional biotechnology subjects. So you will be learning about plant biotechnology. But the maximum information that plant biotechnology syllabus will take you is up to protoplast fusion or electroporation. That is all. But till now, many of the institutions, our syllabus does not have all these latest things. So these are the subjects which you can learn online also. But if you don't equip yourself with knowledge of these additional advanced subjects, it is going to be difficult. Now, let us relax for some time. And can anybody tell me what is this picture? Anybody? What picture I am showing? Sir, somebody, she's telling something. She's showing some pictures. What is this picture? Anybody? Is able to understand the story behind this picture? Very famous story.
Kundi Karnan, sir. Kundi Devi Karnan.
Very good, very good. Absolutely correct. Absolutely correct. Birth of Karnan. So, Lord of the Lord Sun, Surya Bhagavan. is blessing Kunti Devi and a baby is born. So like this he will do, light will come and she becomes pregnant and Karnan is born. How is this possible? So in ancient times they will tell all kinds of stories, but something is happening. And if you look at this next picture, our sun god is revered a lot in our Indian tradition. We worship the sun god as the supreme. Very often we worship him. He's in fact the first god to be worshipped in many cases. And every day you see lot of people, they are standing up to their waist in the water. If they are having river, they will stand up to the waist in the water and they will start praying to the sun. So the first rays of the sun, they are allowed to hit on you. And they will not wear any clothes. Usually the men, they will not wear any clothes in the body. And they will worship the sun like that. And they will do the Surya Namaskaram, all these things they will do. Why they do all these things? Is there some scientific rationale behind it? Why they are dipping themselves inside the water? So all of these things have some scientific knowledge. So what is it? Let us see, try to see what Ayurveda tells us. So on the left side, you can see the Ayurveda. On the right side, you can see the circadian cycle. Okay, the circadian cycle is for our biological bodies. And please don't think you are a biological body, you are a collection of cells. So in the left side, you can see the circadian Ayurvedic cycle, Vata, Pitta, Kapha. And you can see from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. what is happening to you. And the same thing, if you look at the circadian cycle, especially if you look at the blood pressure, BP, you can see at 6:45, sharpest blood pressure rise will be there. Melatonin will stop, which means you start becoming awake. When melatonin secretion starts, you're going to sleep. So when the teacher is going to around, reverse will happen. When the teacher is taking the class, melatonin secretion starts for you, for many people. So in the evening, you have highest body temperature, highest blood pressure. So these things are there because of these things. In order to regulate the metabolic activity, we are following these things. And when you look at this, when you translate this time into the cellular generation time, if you try to correlate it mathematically, because you guys are learning mathematics also, M1, M2, M3, M4. So when you are learning mathematics, you are learning biostatistics, you should also understand how to correlate the mathematics between the circadian cycle and your own cellular regeneration time. So what is the time taken for mitosis to take place? One cell to become another cell, one cell to become 10 to the power of 10 cells. What is the generation time? What is the seriousness of learning the generation time? So that we should understand. Because in today, in COVID scenario, you know the seriousness. How much time does the virus take to develop, to demonstrate the symptoms in the host? How long does it take? So that these kinds of implications are there. Now, let us go into the next part. So we know that there is an electromagnetic spectrum and we have been using this laminar airflow for a very long time. We switch on the UV light for sterilization. And you might recall that if you switch on the UV light, you get the formation of the pyramid and dimers, which will destroy those microorganisms at the genetic level. So this is something which we are all familiar with. If we are able to accept this, then we should also be able to accept that the sunlight contains most of these radiations. So when the sunlight contains many of these radiations, they actually are having an effect on your cells also. So it makes perfect common sense to stand waist deep in the water, which is actually acting as a temperature regulator, and you are worshipping the sun. So as the temperature of the sun is rising throughout the morning, you are submerged in water. So this is like taking an Eppendorf tube and putting it in the buffer solution. So you should understand what you are doing in the laboratory and what is actually happening out there in the real world. It is very similar. Moving on to the real aspect of this. So you can see that today it is used for studying drug delivery systems. So when you are doing drug delivery systems, you are using very precise radiations, precise pulsed laser radiations. They are using the pulsed laser to activate certain hollow nanotubes, small nanotubes like fingers. On each finger, the cells will sit. And when you are passing the radiation, what will happen? You will get a plasmon experience. And when that happens, there is a ripple formation. And in that ripple formation, in that small gap, there is a small disturbance created in the cellular membrane. And whatever you want to send through the nanotube, you can send through the nanotube into the cell. So this is called precision drug delivery. So whatever big jargon you are hearing about drug delivery system, all these big technologies, now we have developed, but you see, long time back, the Surya Bhagavan came to Kunti Devi and passed on this radiation and left. And we are not ready to accept it. it makes perfect scientific sense now when we are doing precision drug delivery. So this is the kind of application that they are. Those who are interested can read papers like this. So these are like titanium oxide nanotubes, which facilitate intracellular drug delivery by laser-assisted photoporation. So electroporation is there. Now we have moved on to photoporation. So what is the significance of technologies like this? I will show you another cartoon because I have a very funny side. I often try to show this. I do not know if the animation is visible to you or not. Okay. For those who do not understand whatever I was telling till now. So previously, on the left side, you can see previously what we used to do for cell delivery. Okay, this is what we used to do with an electron gun. So we used to shoot at random and we hope, so hope that one, at least one of the genes will go inside the cell and sit and make a recombinant one. But emergent technology methods of cell delivery are like this. Very, very precise, very, very sharp and focused. So till now, what skills do you need to learn for understanding all these things? So you need to learn nanotechnology. Apart from biotechnology, you need to learn nanotechnology. Especially there is a field in nanotechnology called nanobiotechnology. So you need to learn that. You need to know optics. Optics, in order to understand the movement of light, in order to understand the behavior of light particles, you need to know optics. Then you need to understand a lot about biomaterial science, because material science is going to be the future of biotechnology. So material science, you should understand it. Otherwise, you cannot develop delivery methods. Then you need to understand biomechanics. Why biomechanics? Not biomechanics means not movement of hand, leg, like what biomedical engineering students, they study. When biotechnology students study biomechanics, you study biomechanics at the molecular level. So biomolecular mechanics. So have you heard of the term biomems? So bio, nano, electromechanical systems, electromechanical systems, MEMS, NEMS, I hope you have heard about these things. So you need to learn this information at the cellular level. So these are the skill sets that you learn to need to understand these things. So this is the next level of emergent biotechnology. So moving on. So this is a screenshot I took when I was watching one YouTube video. There was an advertisement that if you put this sachet into the water and you mix it and you drink it, it contains all these things, vitamin B6, B5, thiamine, alpha, GPC, all these things it contains. What it will do, it is supposed to make you less lazy, it seems. So how they are showing the advertisement is, if you are watching the, before drinking this, you will be doing some work and in between you look at Facebook and WhatsApp. So this is called procrastination. You will actually be wasting time. So if you take this drink, it gives you very sharp focus. This is what they say. And you can see in the list of ingredients that ashwagandha is written. And ashwagandha is traditionally known to be a cognitive enhancer. Cognitive enhancer means it increases cognition. Increasing cognition means it increases your neuronal activity at the present moment, which means at the present moment, I am alert, I am awake, I am speaking, I know what I am speaking, I am not blubbering. So that is what this cognition means. So you should have a good cognition, you should have a good comprehension, good amount of neuronal activity going here and forth. And there are certain chemicals, because your diet is not so good, you are going everywhere and eating whatever you want. And these micronutrients are not getting absorbed in your body. So companies are coming forward and selling it to you. So these are the cellular mechanisms of neurodegeneration. You can see that a lot of these chemicals, if the proteins are not there. Now protein, when you talk about protein, your mind should immediately go back to the central dogma, DNA to RNA, RNA to protein. So there, if certain proteins are misfolded or certain errors are there. So in molecular biology class, you will be learning about DNA mismatch, mismatch repair system. In genetic engineering, you will be learning about the methodologies to rectify the same. But if something happens with the folding wrong, with the folding of the protein, then what happens in case of neuronal proteins? What will happen is, it will lead to Alzheimer's, it will lead to a lot of neuronal degeneration. With age also, this will happen. So why it happens is what is shown in the slide for you, oxidative stress, ecotoxicity, and aggregated proteins. So these are the different things that can happen. So in our tradition, we say that the Vallare Keerai or Indian pennywort is called, that is very good for increasing the neuronal activities. And the future of biotechnology is in development of specific drugs, which are called nootropics. So you can see that there are lots of chemicals. So when you're looking at drug discovery, when you're doing drug development, there are lots of drug molecules, specific activated molecules, which have direct impact on the brain. So they have direct impact on the nerves of your body. So cognitive metabolic enhancers, nootropic vitamins, nutrients, nerve growth promoters, neuroprotectives, natural nootropics, neurohormones, drugs with nootropic properties and xanthines. So many methods are there. So many different types of chemicals have been identified which can take externally. So earlier they used to tell you, you take badam, you take pista and you will become alert because it has a high concentration of zinc and magnesium. But now specific materials which can make the individual smart. So it is not that a person has to be genetically predisposed. It is partly true. Some people are genetically born into such a way that their metabolism allows the retention of such highly cognitively active chemicals, and then they are able to do more brain-related activities. But with the help of these chemicals, you are able to duplicate that behavior in almost every human being, which means we can equalize the cognitive level of human beings. It is possible. So I will take you now a little bit rocket speed. We will go speed of because this is going to DNA as a pen drive. So now you see, you stop with the nootropics and you go into another aspect where the DNA molecule, in the computer, you have two things, zero and one binary. But in DNA, you have four things, adenine, thymine, guanine, cytosine. If it is RNA, then you have uracil. So these things you can actually use as a programming language. You can actually use as a variables for storing data. And this is actually going to be the next level, next stage in what you call as data storage. So I told you in the beginning that there is a lot of data that needs to be stored, omics. And now your computer storage devices are not enough. Your big server rooms are not enough. Your huge memory banks are not enough. So what do you need? You need biological material. Because you see in the biological cell, lot of information is available inside the DNA itself. Your entire genome is available in each and every cell. So the same principle, if you can replicate, you can store thousands and thousands, I mean millions of movies in a single strand of DNA. So this is text technology is also being explored in a huge way. And this is already happening. Okay, this is already happening. And they have started storing small bits of data already. And maybe within 10 years, it is going to happen. So if you want to get into research in these areas, it is going to be readily accepted and you are going to get the admission into that college. So this university, this institute in Harvard University, they are working extensively on this area. And you can go to their website and visit also. So DNA as a pen drive. So I've just put a fancy title there, but really it is about the utilization of biological molecules as data storage devices. So that is the real implication. Right. So I do not know how many of you have seen this web series in Netflix. So nowadays OTT is very famous. The Netflix you have seen means there is a movie serial called, there is a web series called Altered Carbon. Okay. In this movie, what happens is the entire consciousness, the entire information about the person is downloaded into a small chip like this. And this chip is implanted into any body, not just your body. It can be taken and put in the body of some other person. And you will start behaving like that person will start behaving like you. So it is called a stack. And today we have this technology in the form of lab on a chip. So this bio-NEMS and bio-MEMS, which I was talking about earlier, that makes these things possible. Nanofluidic technology, it makes this possible where you can stimulate the entire organ system of an organism in a chip, in a small chip. Which means it only takes a couple of chips to stimulate an entire population. Which means you can actually download biological information onto electronic devices. So in the previous slide, I was talking about downloading biological information, digital information into biological materials. Here, I am talking about uploading biological information into digital format. So both these possibilities are now a reality. And this is the next level of biotechnology. Because if you do not understand the entire deep process of transcription or translation or what each protein will do, you will not be able to create these lab on a chip systems. So this is the next future of biotechnology. And now everybody is doing this. Whenever you see, they are always talking about this. But the real next level is bioprinting. So 3D printing has come. 5D printing has come there, but bioprint to be the future of everything. because if you cut off your finger, you can put a new finger. If you cut off your ear, you can fit a new ear. But the real implication is that the bottom left side, if you see, you can see an entire heart. So what they are doing is they are actually decellularizing the heart so that it loses its identity. How does your heart know that it is your heart? Because it has all the cells that have the genetic construction of your body. Okay, it says everywhere it is Manoj, 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 Manoj. If you wipe it off with a buffer, if you clean the slate with a buffer, then it is just a covering. There is no genetic blueprint or genetic fingerprint of the heart. It is a decellularized tissue material. Now you can imprint whatever you want, or you can make some other fellow's cells grow on that particular heart, and it will take over that heart and it will say, yeah, this is Ramesh or this is Suresh. So that is the kind of technology that is already happening. And you can see the traditional top left side. This is what I used to do as a student, cell culture in bottles. Then nowadays people are doing nano scaffolding they're doing. And this is the Professor Nakamura. This is Professor Nakamura who discovered bioprinting. And this is Dr. Scott Atala. So Atala lab he's having, he has developed a lot of 3D printed tissue materials. And this is the 3D printer itself. I do not know if you can see my mouse curves are moving. This is the 3D printer itself. So 3D printing is going to be the next emergent biotechnology, because all of these things are in biotechnology only. So you should understand it. It is a transdisciplinary. Don't say it is transdisciplinary. It is interdisciplinary. So Sir is talking about what are the areas in biotechnology. I mean, what are the areas in electronics which are related to biotechnology? No, I am not talking about that. These are all biotechnology which are using other technologies in order to expand itself. So this is the further development of biotechnology happening right in front of your eyes. So cell culture plate, you are having nano culture plate now. So this is how 3D printing is done. So finally, you'll have a living tissue. Let me tell you, there is a company called Organovo. So I wanted to put a lot of slides, but there is a company called Organovo where you have what is called, you are actually able to grow meat. So you put meat inside a burger and you can eat it. And in the future, many of this meat, many of this tissue material is going to be laboratory grown. And you need not wait for a skin graft or an organ transplant anymore. This will happen in less than 25 years. Okay, even now, very simple cells or grafts are done using these technologies, cell culture technologies, they're doing it. And stem cell therapy has come to restore patients with Alzheimer's who are losing their neurons. So these things are happening right now. Right, let's go to the next one. So one question I want to ask is, how to preserve the microbes or the cells indefinitely or for prolonged periods? So excuse me, I want to drink some water. So you please answer this question.
Cryopreservation.
Yes, Kanna?
So it may be done through cryopreservation.
Very good, very good. Cryopreservation. You are using very good words. Good, good, good. So cryopreservation we use. You buy vegetable from the market. Mummy buying vegetable from the market. Daddy going to market. You going to market, buying something, bringing it back. How do you put it? You put it in the freezer or you put it in the fridge. Now, which one you will put in the freezer? Which one you will put in the fridge? Buy some chicken, mutton, you will put it in the freezer. Buy some vegetables, you will put it in the fridge. There itself, you are doing differential freezing technology. We are not using cryopreservation there. Cryo means you are using liquid nitrogen. Almost, it almost means that way. It is not exactly that way, but it means that way. But we do a lot of preservation techniques usually by taking it to a lower temperature. So that is what I wanted to say. When you are taking the cells to a lower temperature, naturally the metabolic rate will slow down. And the cells will completely stop. The cellular activity will start slowing down. It may eventually stop, or it may be functioning at a rate at which we cannot detect also. So it is obviously expected that this activity can be brought back. So if you are keeping chicken in the freezer, when you take it back out of the freezer and you keep it for frying, then you take it and fry it and eat it, you don't know about it. But what if you take a live chicken and you put it in the freezer, you freeze it, and then you take it and put it in the kitchen and allow it to thaw. Will the chicken become alive? Very, very simple question. Chicken will not come alive. So the chicken will stay dead. Why does it stay dead? Because you have done a lot of things to it. First of all, you did not tell the chicken that you are going to freeze it. Without its knowledge, you took, without getting permission from the chicken, you took the chicken and you put it in the freezer. So naturally, the chicken is in a lot of stress. So a lot of stress-related enzymes have been secreted into the cell already. Already the cellular damage has started. On top of that, you have taken it out of the freezer. It has died already. All the cellular activity has stopped. Now you are taking it out of the fridge and you are putting it in the open. You are allowing it to thaw without any regulation. Now what will happen as it thaws, the ice crystals, what they will do, they will start tearing the flesh. So all the tiny blood vessels, all the small nerves, everything would have been cut off when it is thawing. And naturally the chicken looks like a chicken, but it is no longer alive. So this is why we are not able to bring frozen things back to life. But we do it every day in the laboratory for bacteria. So the process is quite different there. Because there, actually I'm not going to answer the question here. You actually go and read why that is happening. Okay, so we will move into the next level of freezing. Slide is moving. Yes. So this is frozen chicken freezing, what we know. Then we know about liquid nitrogen. So one student has told about cryopreservation, you told her. Then we all know about lyophilization. So all the biotechnology students will learn about freeze drying. But here you see most perfectly preserved mammoth in Antarctica, Leuba. The most perfectly frozen mammoth is there. So this is indicative that preservation can be done in order to retain the physiological status, but not yet about the metabolic status. We do not know whether we can restore the metabolic status. So let us go into that. Now I'll show you something. I'll show you a technology called vitrification. So vitrification is the use of rapidly freezing a biological specimen, but by using certain cryopreservatives. So on the left side, you can see a tissue sample which has been frozen normally. On the right side, you can see a tissue sample which has been frozen using the technology of vitrification. In the center, you can see a photograph of a kidney's tissue. Left side, frozen kidney, white. Right side, vitrified tissue. You see the integrity is still there. It still looks like a kidney. So this kind of technology is there. And then there is a frog. So I thought of showing the frog in the presentation, but then it might take too much time. But there is a frog which will freeze in the winter and wake up in the summer. And nobody can understand how it is doing that. It will turn into a rock and then it will come back alive. And we still haven't figured out beyond, we have not gone beyond vitrification itself. So the only next stage we have gone from vitrification is equilibration. So that is another technology. So a few technologies we are having. But with these technologies itself, we are able to understand that you can start to freeze human beings. So there is a company in America called Alcor, which is already freezing humans near the point of death and putting them in big cryopreservative jars so that in the future somewhere technology will come to wake them up. So this is already happening. So you can read about this online. So what they do, just when the person is about to die or when the person is dead, they would have previously signed a will also. So what they will do, they will take the body, they will slowly infuse it in the cryopreservative, they will vitrify the tissues. And they will preserve it. If you don't have any money, enough money to preserve your body, you can take only the head. Discount offer is there. So that you can do. So this is probably in expectation that these technologies will work. And it might be entirely possible that thawing technologies will increase in the future. So thawing technologies will only increase if you're able to understand the real implications of biotechnology, which proteins need to be reactivated. That we still do not know. So which is the protein which will do something, which is active? Whenever you say something, you do. Whenever you want to break something, you say ligase. Whenever you want to join something, you say ligase. So whenever you want to do something active, in physics, we call it kinetic energy. So kinases. So a lot of kinases are involved. So what are the enzyme systems involved? What are the protein systems which are involved? This we have to study. And that is what I told you, proteomics, in the beginning of the lecture. So I think we are almost towards the end of my talk. So on the left side, you can see that we are actually trying to mimic the human eye. in electronic systems. So when we are building robots, so when robotics, when people are doing, they are actually taking biological data. And the biological data, they are not just taking from the human eye. They are also trying to mimic the insect eye. Insect eye is compound eye. It is much better than our eyes. We are having only one eye. They are having so many eyes in that single ball. So they are able to see all around. So robotics, in robotics, no, they are using these kinds of methodologies. They are taking the information how the cell, the rods and cones are arranged, the proteins are arranged. Because these proteins are not only responsible for, in this eye problem, I can say they are responsible for visualization. But in certain other cases, they are responsible for camouflage. Then they have defense application. So this is what is called as bio-inspired design. So bio-inspired design, you take all the biological activities or physiological activities or genetic traits of the organism, and you try to replicate it in the engineering designs. So from biology, it moves into engineering. So this is another future for biotechnology. And I think that brings us to the end of the lecture, and I will summarize. So here, what you want to learn, what skills do you have to learn in order to understand all the things that I just told you, starting from Karna. So cryonics you need to learn, then bio-inspired design, design thinking, you should know how to do design thinking, cell culture in advanced way. So what are cell culture techniques? What are cell preservation techniques you need to understand? Food preservation technologies, you need to learn a lot of things. So these are the different technologies that you can learn. Almost over, madam. So these are the skills that are other than CRISPR, synthetic biology, and metabolic engineering. So I have summarized what all the skills you need here. Okay. So starting from data analytics, big data, Python programming, data mining, nanotechnology, optics, material science, biomechanics, plant informatics, precision agriculture, cryonics, food preservation. So thank you very much for the opportunity given, and thank you, madam, and thank you, sir. So that's it from me. Thank you.
Thank you.